goods and service tax act. So now, as many of us are working from home and getting appointed with foreign companies, as a freelancer, this comes in very important. And so we should be aware of the goods and service, the basics, at least the basics of goods and service tax act. So first we'll clear, understand the concept, what is goods and what is services. So goods is any kind of movable property, except money or securities, like mutual funds and shares, or money like hard money. Anything other than that is considered as goods. What are services? Services are anything other than goods. Means whatever is left out after goods, money and securities are removed. Whatever you provide is service. So even in basic concept, we know what is goods and services. But services also includes anything. Suppose if you are exchanging dollar for money, INR, the bank charges you the amount. So that amount, that money would be considered as service, not the Indian rupee. The bank, the charges which bank charge would consider to be a service. Important point is what we provide into as an employee to the employer, that would not be covered under services. It has specifically been excluded from the services definition. And what is supply? Supply is anything which you provide for something exchange for your business. One important point is to be remembered is that there has been a ruling of the courts that the income which you receive from interest as from banks, that would be also considered as a service. So why this is important, I'll explain you further. So the basic definition for goods and services are this. Even interest received would be considered as service, though no interest is, no GST is payable on it, but it would be considered as a service. So what is, how is GST charged when you are liable to GST? GST is based on your turnover, how much your turnover is earned during the year. So what is turnover? Turnover is not only of the goods which are chargeable under GST. Suppose you are purchasing, if you are trading in laptops, or suppose you are providing services in India which are chargeable to GST. That is included even if you are selling some goods which are mentioned at 0%, like if any good which are essential items, which are taxed at zero rate, even that would be included in your turnover, which are zero rated. Means if you are exporting something, government has given the benefit, if you are exporting, you can charge 0%. Even that would be included in your turnover. And the service and the goods which on which GST is not levyable. Like if you are providing, if you are selling petrol, if you're saying oil, if you're selling petrol, diesel, and liquor, if you are selling this, even though no GST is charged on it, it will be included in your total turnover. And if your total turnover exceeds the given limit, then you have to register under GST. So that main thing is only taxable items are not considered on your turnover. Even your exempt portion will be also considered. As I mentioned in last slide, that in court ruling, interest income is also considered as service. So even if you are you have to include your interest for calculating the total turnover. So if your income from your profession, income from your interest, total you will find the total, and then if you see if you cross the limit or not. These are the GST applicability thresholds. Government has initially given some benefits for northeastern region, some special category states. Then there were some amendments. The states, Somoto themselves wanted to get more threshold. So this is basic one chart which will help you understand. If you are based in one of these states, then what is the limit? The first one is goods. So if you are dealing only in goods, then in that case, your limit is 10 lakh rupees for these states. If you are in Arunachal Pradesh and other states mentioned in third row, then you can see the limit is 20 lakhs. Only if you're dealing in goods, then this limit is applicable to you. If you are dealing in goods and you are selling the goods only in your state, then in that case, these limits are applicable. In other states, it is 40 lakhs. In case of services, which we all are majorly concerned of, in the first category state, it would be 10 lakh rupees. In other also, it is 10 lakhs. In other states, it is 20 lakhs. So there is no increase in this limit. So for normal category states, it is 20 lakhs. And for northeastern region, and Puducherry and Telangana, it is 10 lakh rupees. And if you are providing goods and services both, in that case, the limits are this. That is same as that of service. I share the PPT with you so you can easily refer that. Just remember, these thresholds are, you have to consider the criteria. Only if goods, then this. If services, only if services, then this. And goods and services, then you have to consider the last column. So this is the flowchart which will help you get more idea on that. If you understand the, if you remember the limits, see, if you are dealing in goods, if you are selling only within the state, and your turnover is 40 lakhs, the 40 lakhs is for normal states. For other states, for special category state, it will be 20 lakhs and 10 lakhs. Refer the last table and then this presentation. If your turnover is up to 40 lakhs, then you can so motto voluntarily register under it. If you are selling outside the state, then any turnover, if you sell even 10 rupees, if you provide service of even of 100 rupees, sell goods of 100 rupees, then you have to compulsory register under the GST Act. If you are selling goods, so within the state, you can sell up to 40 lakhs. But if you sell outside the state, even of 100 rupees, you have to get yourself registered under GST. Our part service. So if you are providing only services, then you can, you did not register if your turnover is up to 20 lakhs. Up to 20 lakhs, you can voluntarily register in case you need to register, because sometimes it may happen that your vendor, your client, suppose he is based in India and he wants the party to be genuine, there are certain criteria when a professional may be hired. So in that case, they may want a person to be GST registered. So you can take voluntary registration. And if your turnover exceeds rupees 20 lakhs, then you can take compulsory registration. So they have provided a benefit that even if you are, if you provide services outside the state of your registration, suppose you are registered in Delhi and you are providing services to Mumbai, Maharashtra. So even if your turnover does not exceed 20 lakhs, then you did not register under GST. That one benefit has been given only for service providers. And in case you are providing both goods and services, then any turnover outside the state will be required to register under GST, and only if within the state, then the criteria of 20 lakhs will be applicable. Refer this flow chart along with the limits of your respective states. These 40 lakhs and 20 lakhs I have used because these are normal category. Normal, most of the states are using this criteria. This is the criteria for special considerations for these states and normal category of 40 lakhs and 20 lakhs. So major of the states fall under normal category, and few states, that is mostly of northeastern region, and few Puducherry and Telangana and Uttarakhand have been included in this. So when you have to apply for registration, if you are doing voluntary registration, you can do it anytime. It does not matter if you have started your business or not. Means it does not matter if you have any turnover. If you are, even if your turnover is zero, you are searching for clients, you can so want to get applied under registration, voluntary registration. In compulsory registration, if you cross your threshold, if you cross the limit of 40 lakhs or say 20 lakhs, whichever is applicable to you, you have to get yourself registered within 30 days of the crossing of the threshold. And if you are e-commerce operator is the one like Amazon. How is Amazon? It is a platform for other sellers to cater the vendors. So if you are like Amazon, if you are an electronic e-commerce operator, then you need to compulsory get registered under GST irrespective of your turnover. If you are selling, if you own a website, if you own a platform where you sell your own goods, then you did not register under this. But if you are providing platform for others to sell, then in that case you have to register under you have to get compulsory registered from the first day itself. There are also other compliances for e-commerce operator. I'm not covering this under this because this is just a basic session. And as I stated in the last slide, if you are providing goods or services which are exempt, which are taxable at 0%, and if you are providing within the state, then you are not required to apply for registration. If you are selling it outside your state, even if they are exempt, you have to get registered under GST. So what are the basic details you required for registration? Registration government has made the registration online, so you need not visit the offices. Basic details are required like name, PAN card, Aadhaar card. These are the list. Basic IDs which are easily available with you. If you are individual, many of these are not applicable. Like authorized signatory, you yourself would be authorized signatory. You did not mention. You do not have to submit any proof of identity entity. If you are a partnership, if you are a company, then you have to submit your registration letter with the GST portal. So these are basic things which you already have. Just you need a point of remember for address of proof of business. If you're starting at your own home, like or from home, then if you are getting it registered under your father's name, the light bill is electricity bill is under your father's name. So get a NOC, that is no obligation certificate from the father, and then you can upload it. Once you are registered under GST, you have to remember important points that if you are registered under GST, you are allotted GST number. You have to display that under your name board. Like we put our name boards outside our offices. So remember to mention the GST number. It should be mentioned on your invoices. It should be used on all communications with the department. You should display your registration certificate in the business premise. These are all the compulsory things which you have to follow. And as soon as you're registered under GST, you have to charge GST on every taxable supplies. Means whenever there is a requirement to charge GST, you have to charge GST. And communicate your GST to all the suppliers who are supplying you services. Like if you're taking service of internet services, make those internet provider aware of your GST number so you can take the GST credit. So important thing now, which you all are engaged currently, is export of service. So what actually is export of service? There are 5 points which are need to be remembered to what is defined as export of service. The service, the supplier of service is located in India, means you. Suppose you are the server or supplier, you are located in India. The recipient is located outside India. The company or the client is based outside anywhere in outside India. The place of service is outside India, means you are supplying the services outside India. The payment has been received by the supplier in convertible foreign exchange. This is where the main point of where major of us were having the queries is. You have to receive the payment in foreign currency exchange. What is happening is that when the client was transferring the amount, he was transferring the amount like the Wise app, the Wise mediator. He was transferring the money through Wise, and Wise was also holding rupee out in India. He was transferring INR to another account. So what we received is actually the Indian rupee and not any foreign currency. So if this condition fails, your service does not classify as export of service. So one thing you have to remember is always ask for the recipient of your always ask your clients to transfer the amount in foreign exchange currency. Even if they are transferring through Wise, ask them to send in USD or Euro. USD, Euro, Pound Sterling are freely convertible exchange. So ask them to transfer this in your account so that you can get a proof of receiving foreign exchange. The department has made an amendment that this can be received in Indian currency, but that definition has been very vague, and they have just brought into for those who want to take benefit under foreign trade policy. So for us, the important would be still that you have to receive the amount in foreign convertible exchange. And the last is not be bothering so much to you, because it is that you and the client should be two separate persons. It should not be your branch or like that. Means you are not just providing services for taking GST benefit. The main point for you to will be the point number 4, that you should receive the foreign, you should receive your remittance in foreign currency. If you are receiving it through Wise or any through other intermediary, ask the client to transfer to remit the amount in USD or euros. If you ask them to send the amount in INR, you would be receiving the amount in INR, so that would not fulfill the condition of export. Remember this one very important point. This is what the summary. You are providing the services from India to outside for the rest of the world, and then remitting in foreign currency, then that would be considered as export of services. Now, why foreign remittance proof is necessary? Because goods, if we see goods, they are tangible. We can see them, we can feel them, we can see them being exported. But we cannot say the same for services, because services are intangible. So for foreign remittance acts as a proof that you have actually exported the services. So if your service is an export, if your service classifies to the export of service, you have two options that you can either export it with charging GST or without charging GST. You consider the first option of charging with exporting without GST. When you export without charging GST, first thing you have to undertake is filing a letter of undertaking. It has to be filed once in a year. That is, at the commencement of the year itself, you have to file LUT. LUT is nothing but you declare to the government that you state to the government that you will be following all the rules and regulations which are mentioned under GST. You will be exporting the service and you will be receiving the payment in foreign currency. And in case of any default, you will be paying the damages to the government. These all are already typed there. You just have to tick mark on it. And you will be needing two witnesses, independent witnesses. You just have to just mention their name and addresses, and you have to submit the form. If you upload a submission of the form, you can export your services without charging any GST, and you can claim the refund of GST input services. Like if you are hiring any professional to assist you, and he's charging you GST, if you are taking services of any internet service provider, and he's charging you GST, you can claim the refund of it. One thing to remember, you cannot claim the GST input credit of capital goods such as laptop or anything which you're capitalizing your books. Under LUT, that provision has not been made, though follow-ups are being made to the government, but as such, no amendment has been made. The second option is charging GST while exports. Why this option is selected? Because see, you have to charge export at the rates applicable. Usually for the services, this is 18%. Then you can set up the GST credit with your liability. So you can here you can take the GST credit of your laptop. And you can set it up against your exports liability. And then while filing the refund claim, you can claim whole of your GST liability. So in that case, you can claim the refund of your laptop. But this process involves a lot of compliances. You have to show them continuous proof. And the main thing is your blockage of working capital. Because first you have to pay the 18% GST on it. First, you have to pay 18% GST, and as and when the authority approves your refund, then only you will be receiving the GST. So till that, your amount is blocked, and in case it does not sanction your refund, then the whole of your GST gets blocked, and you will not be receiving anything. So next will be GST chargeability. So if your service qualifies to be an export service, if you fulfill all the conditions, then you can export the service at 0%. But if even if the single condition fails for a transaction, it is not for the whole year. If for that transaction, if any of the condition is not fulfilled, then you have to charge at 18% or the any rate specified. If you provide the services locally within India, then you have to charge GST at 18% because that is not an export of service. Once you're registered under GST, you have to charge GST on everything, on every supply you make. How you charge GST? If you are selling without the same state, if you're supplying within the same state, you have to charge CGST and SGST, means central GST and state GST. If it is 18%, 9% CGST, 9% SGST. If you are supplying outside the state or outside India, then you have to charge IGST, which is 18%. This is just the breakup of tax for the department government's understanding. The rate would be 18% each. Just remember, if you are registered under GST, you have to charge GST on every supply you make. Only if it export, then you have to consider at 0%. Now, when is the liability to file GST returns? There are mainly two returns you have to comply for the whole year. One is GST R3B and another is GST R1. GST R3B is the summary of all the outward supplies you make and all the purchases, all the ITC which you have received during the quarter, during the period. There are two options. You can file it monthly or quarterly. It is compulsory for though monthly for those whose turnover in the last year. Suppose if you are filing the year return for the month of April 2020-21, then your turnover for the year 2020-21, that is last year, if it exceeds 5 crore, or you so motu want to file it monthly, then you can have to file it monthly, and in that case, your due date would be 20th of the succeeding month. And in case you file for quarterly, that once in 3 months, then in that case, your due dates will be 22. Here, there are category of states, category one, category two. I'll share with you the details. So if you are based in anywhere in category one state, in that case, your due date will be 22 of the month following the quarter. Like for April to June, your quarter ends on June, your due date will be 22nd of the next month. In category state, two state, it will be 24th July. After the summary return, you have to file GSTR-1. It is the details of all the outward supplies you have made during that period. You have to just mention the party's name, if he is registered under GST, the GST number, the date of the invoice number, the amount and everything. The GST return has a separate column for export. So you have to mention if exports are there, you have to remember specifically to disclose your export details under that head. Because when you file the refund application, there will be mismatch in your GSTR-1 because you have not disclosed anything as exports. So remember while filing GSTR-1, even while filing GSTR-3B, there are specific columns given to mention your exports. Here also, there are two options to file monthly and quarterly. Again, same conditions, if turnover is more than 5 crores in last year, or you have to assume to file it monthly, the due date would be 11th of the next month. For April, it would be 11th of May. If you are filing quarterly, then in that case, it would be 13th, irrespective of the states you reside in. So that for April to June, your due date would be 13th of July. Remember the late fee for filing GSTR-3B. If you have sale during the, if you have any outward sale and you are filing late, then it will be 50 rupees per day. And if there is no sale, you have deal return, then it would be 20 rupees per return. For GSTR-1, the late fees are rupees 100 per day. As of now, the government is not charging it. Means they have not specifically mentioned where to pay the fees, but the rule has come into application. If GSTR-1 is also filed late, you have to pay rupees 100 per day. Then it is GSTR-9. This is a one-time annual return. This is the summary of all the returns you have filed. This is summary of the whole year, which every normal taxpayer has to file. It is to be annual. And it has to be filed by 31st December of every financial year. Also for April to March, year ends in March. And you have to file the return by 31st December. In case there is any liability, suppose you are filing GST return quarterly, and in April there is one payment for which you have to make GST payment, then a separate challan is to be raised. A challan is to be filed, and that challan has to be reflected in these returns. These are the category of the states. Category 1, where the due dates are 2 days early as compared to category 2 states. So southern region, central and southern region falls into category 1, and northern and central, northern central region, northeast region falls under category 2 states. This is majorly done because due to the heavy load which falls on the servers due to the last date issues. So there is a difference of 2 days. Southern and central region falls under category 1. And others fall into category 2. So this was what I tried to do, cover up the basics which you need to be aware of as on your end. Regarding would be the then would be specific topics. This is what I tried to cover this. If you have any questions, you can ask now.